Are you trying to be a successful business person in China? Or are you simply curious about this emerging economy? There will be 5 episodes, each dealing with a different but all interrelated aspect of Chinese economy. 1. Chinese rural economy, the key driving force of the whole economy. 2. China manufacturing and export industry, which absorbs migrant workers coming from the countryside. 3. Urbanization, the development of cities that need to accommodate this migratory flux. 4. China banking system, how all this development is financed. 5. China economic model and the challenges brought by such fast development. I am Michele Geraci, Head of China Economic Policy Program at Nottingham University Business School, China. I'm a Senior Research Fellow and Adjunct Professor at Zhejiang University, and I'm the Head of China for the Global Policy Institute. Please follow me. I will tell you something about China that maybe you don't know yet. Hello everybody, Ni Man Hao, and welcome to our first episode of China Economy and Society. Today, we start our first series of documentaries and we talk about Chinese rural economy. Because in order to understand the Chinese economic development model and the business opportunity that China offers, we need first to understand how the rural economy operates. And this is true no matter if your business activities relate to manufacturing electronic products, textile, or any other sector. China economy is a complex and interrelated ecosystem, and the beginning is in the countryside. China's future growth relies largely on the migration flow of farmers that move from the countryside to the cities. This provides an input to economic growth. And this is quite natural. Everyone seeks a better life, higher salaries, better living conditions, and access to more services. China has been very successful in adopting this growth model over the last 30 years, since the opening up and reform policies introduced in 1978 by Deng Xiaoping. This has worked until now, but what about the future? Today, GDP forecast relies largely on the assumption that this flow of migrants will continue for the next 2 decades, and about 12 million people per year are expected to move from the countryside to the cities. However, this is what the farmers themselves think. Let's hear them. So, is the general belief that such migration flow is going to be guaranteed in the future too optimistic? Does China economic growth face challenges? To answer these questions, we travel to Guizhou, in the southwest of China. Guizhou is the province with the lowest GDP per capita of $2,200 per year, compared to that of Shanghai that reaches more than $10,000 per year. But let's first briefly review the history of rural reforms. Before 1978, no matter how high farmers' production yield was, their income was capped, and therefore there was no incentive to work harder to produce more. Then Deng Xiaoping introduced sweeping reforms that allowed farmers to retain any additional output that could be sold for extra income. One does not have to have a Nobel Prize to understand that this completely changed the dynamics of production. One of the most important results of these reforms was the dramatic increase in farmers' income. This graph shows the evolution of both the rural and urban personal income from 1978 until today. Back in 1978, the average income for a rural resident was only 130 renminbi. Today it has reached 7,000 renminbi, an increase of more than 50 times. At the same time, urban citizen income also increased from 340 renminbi back in 1978 to more than 22,000 today. I like to divide this 30 years period since reforms into three stages. During the first decade, the urban to rural income ratio decreased significantly, indicating that the early beneficiaries of reforms were indeed farmers. I call this the Deng Xiaoping era, who was himself originally from a rural province of Sichuan. Then, from 1990 to 2004, economic development shifted in favor of urban development, in particular coastal cities. This is the period where Jiang Zemin was a preeminent figure. He himself was a former mayor of Shanghai. Finally, in the last decade, under the leadership of Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao, which introduced the concept of harmonious society, the urban to rural income ratio remained pretty much stable. Therefore, if you want to forecast the evolution of this ratio, you simply need to look at the background and the place of origin of the current leadership. Despite the growing income disparity, there has been an exceptional improvement in the living condition. 30 years of reforms have lifted 400 million out of poverty. This is an unprecedented achievement in the history of mankind. No matter what your views are about the Chinese system, they have achieved something that no one else has ever done before. Agriculture remains a very important sector of the economy, contributing about 12% of the GDP and employing about 25% of the total population, or 300 million people. Naturally, climate and geography determines which product is cultivated in which areas. For example, rice is mostly grown in the southern western part of China, where a mild and wet climate favors sometimes two and even three harvests per year. Corn, wheat, soya beans are normally grown in the northeastern part of China. Unlike western countries, China rural residents face various challenges, such as access to credit, land property rights, and the Hukou system, which is the registration system adopted in China that basically separates a citizen into rural and urban citizen.
我认为在农村生活很不容易。不容易。我对我的经济情况不太满意，自己做一点小生意啊什么的，在农村就是这样。开心的时候，每就是一天呢，希望生意好一点呗，就开心了嘛。想到城市来赚点钱，买房子吧。我的梦想就是走出去以后，有自己的事业，然后让家里面的人都幸福。
The economic condition in the rural areas is not, in my view, as dire as it appears. Yes, average income is only one third of those living in the cities. But that's not the whole story. The cost of living in the rural areas is only a fraction of that in the cities. Farmers have land, which represents a secure and pretty much stable source of income. Housing is free. Food is almost guaranteed by their own land or that of the neighbors. Furthermore, even if working in the fields can be tiring, over the course of the year, only a few weeks are actually spent toiling in the fields, during harvesting and seeding time. The rest of the time is spent relaxing, enjoy the company of family and friends. Furthermore, during those periods, if they wish, they could also do part-time jobs in local shops or other activities related to the agriculture, which would further increase their income. So we know that farmers' income is very low, about 1,200 US dollars per year. But we also know that a large part of that comes from other activities, such as part-time jobs or remittance from family members who move to the cities. So that the actual income coming from pure rural activities is only 500 US dollars per year. Working as a farmer is not a very lucrative activity. So what can they do to increase their income? A few options. They can buy better fertilizer, invest in agricultural machinery, or move up the value chain. Instead of growing rice, move up to grow peppers or even animal husbandry. But where do they find the funds to invest? Can microcredit be the answer to that? Let's see.
那我种植呢就是这个栽树，栽果树。那为了做这个小投资一些钱吗？投资都要搞的话就要十多万。那收入回得到多少？那个就要三年时间就全部回收。那这个是我们这里的野菜，这个也是。这个相当于说比较帮助消化，你可以尝一下。
那如果现在你还想借钱，为了不要做大米，要那个，那就是有办法你可以借钱。如果你去银行，银行呢现在只给我们贷一万块钱，
一万，
一万，那不一万不够，我就不要了。
你需要四万对吗？
对对对。
这基本上现在没什么办法
啊，没有办法了，
他就是做大米的，
就种大米辅导口啊，这种米还没有经济投资嘛，对不对？是啊，就是这个道理。
你们年轻人一样的嘛？如果你想借钱，比如说开店还是什么样，有办法能不能借钱去银行？
你如果给朋友借啊，可能一万块、两万块可能好借。那么如果是，那如果你想投资这开店做什么？那就那基本上是没那个可能，因为你自己，你除了有房，如果有房产证的话，像银行贷款可以贷到。
The beautiful family that we have just met have told us about the problem in borrowing money. They have been successful to borrow part of it to repair their homes. But when it comes to borrow even more to grow even higher yielding products or move to higher valued products, then they find difficulties and they have to recur to family and friends or to the shadow banking system, which charges very high interest rates. We heard about 5% per month.
农村的贷款不好贷，对不对？哎，
一分钱都贷不到。
退伍当过兵，我牛个工，我是双桶工，长期准，贷款不要利息。
两三万。
两三万。
嗯。国家几头几头？
六七千哦。啊、
哦，两三万吧。
就是一两万那些嘛。
一两万，嗯。
三万块钱。
亲戚，问，所以我们邻居呢，
向银行。
去银行借吗？
银行借。
银行贷款。
因为他不晓得你哪个吧，我们在家上也被他贷过款，
做点事嘛，结果没做成。
就是做生意。
我老是开宾馆，承包饭店，到县城里承包饭店。
平常做什么周转不过来嘛，就去借嘛。
那你这里你的声音这里是什么样的？你是从事什么行
业？嗯，我这里我主要是搞辣椒的，辣椒种植嘛，我主要的模式是这个，公司加基地加农户，这块来做的。现在的但是总共有6300多亩。
你开始的生意，你怎么筹资？你这么投资那么多钱，一亩地500块，大概100亩地5万，你借钱了从银行还是怎么样？
找朋友，找其他人来，通过这个多利息的，高利息的这个方面，我主要发展这个产业。
能不能去银行借这些钱吗？
银行里面的手续太多，要求的其他的方面的太高。
他们有什么要求？
你是比如说像你用房产证做抵押，在我们农村是没有房产证的，一般现在的没有房产证，没有。
所以不管是老百姓，还是像你一样的，
像我一样
企业家，规模大的一个商人，也没办法从银行或者什么借钱。都应该是通过朋友的朋友。每一次我去跟你们贵公司一样的这个谈论这个小额贷款的问题，每个人都说哦，对农民来说很容易得到小额贷款。然后我去跟农民商量一下，大部分的人他们都觉得有一点困难，就是贷款找不到。
应该说现在他们对贷不了款这个说法哈，应该是不是太多，只有一部分可能会这样说。第一个就是当时我们评级它是有个条件的，你比如说有拖欠我们以前的不良贷款情况的，还有呢就是说年纪没有达到18周岁以上的，或者是年龄超过65岁以上的。那么其他的时候呢，就是说他们可能会针对它的额度可能不太满意。
你觉得这个行业的未来对你来说会怎么样？需不需要改一些政策、法律？
我们感觉，要是能够政府有建立一些机制，什么担保啊、保险啊，这些有风险可控，可能小额贷款还要更好一些。
提高他们的收入的最好的办法是什么？是借钱？为了做什么？第一个选择，还是搬到城市去那里打工？
我对农村农民的了解，我觉得应该是多管齐下，不是单一的。针对不同的农民，我们有不同的扶持方法。比如说有的农民，我们要给他提供一些信息，支持他搞好生产，扩大他的经营这个范围，扩大再生产。但对一些农民，他没有什么技能，又不能出去打工的这一部分，我们还是要贷款支持他。
We look at microcredit as a way for farmers to increase their income by borrowing money and invest into productive agricultural activities, such as buying better seeds, fertilizers, machineries. However, we found that it is very difficult for farmers to obtain loans, or at least to obtain the full loan, Formal credit institutions such as microcredit companies or banks only tend to lend half of what the farmers demand. The remaining must be borrowed from an informal network of family, friends, and even the informal banking sector. The other problem is farmers normally borrow money to improve their homes, maybe build a bigger house, not to actually invest in agricultural activity. And in my view, this is really not a good use of money. It doesn't do anything to improve their living condition. It doesn't do anything to improve their income. When then farmers go to ask for a second loan, this time to actually use the funds for agricultural activities, then the credit check is more stringent and then the loan is more difficult to obtain. We also found that when we talk to the banks, they're always very happy and eager to lend money to farmers. But then when we talk to farmers, they tell us it is very difficult to obtain loan from those formal institutions. So I think there is at least a communication problem that needs to be addressed. So if microcredit does not quite solve the problem of how to increase farmers' income, where else can it be done? Another possible solution is for farmers to pull together resources, land from the neighbors, and therefore create some economies of scale. And this is what we're going to be talking about next. In China, ownership and use of land is heavily regulated. Farmers do not own the land. The land is instead collectively owned by the village where they live in. Farmers only have rights of use for a limited period of time, which currently expires between the year 2030 and 2050. Although at present there is no law in place, it is reasonable to expect that by then the leasehold period will be further extended, as it has already happened in the mid-90s, when the first 15-year leasehold period expired following the reforms and opening up of the early 80s. Use of land is also regulated, so farmers cannot arbitrarily convert arable land into other uses. So for example, if a farmer grows rice in his plot of land, he cannot decide to raise pigs, even if raising pigs would provide higher revenue. And this is because China needs to meet a minimum production quota of food, and therefore arable land area cannot further decrease. In addition, farmers cannot outright sell their land. They can only lease out their land for about 500 renminbi per year, about $80. By doing this, they free up some time and they can dedicate themselves to other activities. To understand a little bit more about how land rights use affect farmers' income, we travel to the beautiful village of Xijiang, where minority Miao people live and they grow, guess what, rice.
如果有一个大公司，那来这里想，出租的所有的这个土地，这可以的，可以啊，可以啊，就是给每个人一千，你这里，这应该这土地给我们就给我有收入噻，给这个土地那个收入就行了。那现在，土地不属于农民，属于集体。哎，集体。那这个我自己来管理，我来种，但全属还是集体的，
还是集体的。
对，集体的。
为什么？ 所有的人不一起买一个拖拉机，然后一个星期我用，然后我等一会儿我给你一件，然后你给你一件，然后我们都一起，就是一个集体买一个拖拉机，或者
你这个拖拉机没有路，这个没路，没有路。
那新的比如说材料，
哎，你可以我们家可以出去买，买得到，买得着，
嗯，
可以买这种那个机器来说，你看离这块。 走上那块没有路走，没有路开走，
没有走，这个是。
哎，对。
那如果想提高
产品的质量，比如说买一根好的种子或者肥料。
这可以的，可以的，完全可以。
这现在是个人个人买自己的。
对对对，哎哎。
那如果一起买，应该便宜一点，对吗？
啊，一起买。
这个一起买，这个你觉得会觉得就是成本低一点，就是不应该是每个人买咱自己的，就是整个都一起买。
你家里土地不一样，我家里土地不一样。肥与瘦的不一样，
嗯，
用的种子空气也不一样，你再用这个种子，我再用这个种子也不一样，
也不一样，对，
也因地制宜用，
对对对，这个也是。你聊天真的很感谢，感谢，
谢谢了，下次再来啊，好的，好
的，好
的，
拜拜，拜拜，再见，再见。We had a very wow interesting conversation in this beautiful place on a beautiful sunset here in Xijiang village in Guizhou province with Party Secretary Li. What did he tell us? Some problems about the scope of the agriculture. How can we grow the income of farmers? The main problem here is the land allocation per capita is very small. So it is almost impossible to reach economies of scale. Only 500 square meters per head. Then we talked about investment in machinery, but rightly, you know, we looked at the landscape here, it's very mountainous, so tractors and modern machineries here have no place to be. And later on, we will talk to other farmers to hear their opinions.
那不愿意的，
不愿意卖，
不愿意。
都过着的一件，还是不愿意卖出去了。
你买我的土地，我就死了。
因为土地是农民的那个生活的基本保障了嘛，再把土地拿给抵押了，你还对啊？
最后需要那个地方要，一件卖了肯定卖。亩土地大概是3万多块钱吧。
不管多少钱都不能抵押。
5万。
不能抵押。
10万。
不能抵押。
20万。
不能抵押，那个是祖祖辈辈用下来的，5万、10万、20万，回去还不够你一天就用了。
在中国呢？我们所有的农民的土地呢，都是承包国家的土地，意味着呢，所有的农村土地呢，都是国有的，我们只有承包权、使用权，而没有所有权。
那关于土地的使用法，一个农民，假如说现在他种大米，
嗯，
他可以随便换他的种什么？种大米、改养猪，还是种花，还是什么？有什么规定？
我们目前呢，政府倒不能强迫农民，你必须种这样，必须种那样。
嗯、
但是你要知道，我们政府呢依然有很大的权力，就是说，我们叫做说得好，叫做引导农民啊进行产业化。
嗯、
所以说呢，有可能呢，政府呢他指导性的要求农民种玉米、种甘蔗。种果树，那如果说你这样去做的话呢，一个是政府呢可以给你提供补贴。
那你觉得外国人、外国公司来中国投资农业这个行业，会不会受到欢迎？
有一些农业产品，附加值已经非常高了，就像我们刚才讲到的蓝莓，可能中国的中药材，可能一些果树，一些水果、一些干果。那么这些产品呢，我们需要品种，因此要和国外合作。同时呢，现在中国你也知道，农业的污染也比较严重，所以通过和国外合作呢，生产有机方面的产品，这个也是我们很重要的一个途径。
你建议外国人公司来这里投资哪一个方面？农业在哪一个方面？
我要推荐两个。
啊，好的。
第一个呢是这有机农业，有像贵州的话呢，有机茶，或者说有机水稻，这些都非常有潜力。第二个的话呢，是要推荐特色农业，比如说中国的中药材，比如说我们在食品中的太子参，价格非常的高。
好，
这两个行业，
这个两个行业，好的。
你怎么收集那么多？
来，这个都说来就话长了。我从3年以前嘛，今年是第3年，从第一年，我都开始的发展的是50多亩地，那个是通过自己的实验。来看这个品种的产值，还有这个适应的气候，土质，等方面的。但是呢，到了第二年，我都发展到了，300-400亩。
你每一个亩地，你投资多少钱？一年。
一年我给老百姓的是500。
五百元。
一样嘛，每个人每个老百姓收到五
百块。都是一样的，一亩地都是一样的。他来给我自己打工了嘛，可能他一年子就是那个我的这个周期比较短嘛，也就是四个多月嘛。四个多月的他就是给我帮了一百多天，一百四五十天了，一百四五十天呢，他那个要的，他得到的收入就是，七八千左右，不上万的，都是这几个月嘛。
这些东西我是
什么？那到哪的？
我不是发货，我要给你们生意大的，怕你让你们每个人都听得到。好不好，给你们打了多少次电话，就是跟你们讲的，男的不能要，女的不能要，诈骗人不能要，要求的都是三个。
那
看我这个
要成本就要。
So this is the place where the farmers who own their own piece of land come and sell their product to Mr. Liu that we have met before. There is some discussion about the quality, and maybe now we know the reason why farmers sometimes prefer to rent out their land and come here and do work for Mr. Liu instead of producing by themselves. This is the product that they have just collected from the land, and it appears that the quality is not of the best, so there is a little discussion and negotiation about the price. So at the end of the day, these farmers have worked for those days to collect this, may end up home empty-handed. And now we understand that even if the income is not going to grow much more, it's probably best to come here and work for Mr. Liu than go through all this hassle to sell and maybe be rejected at the end. Great taste.
Land ownership and rights of use of land is a complex issue in China. Currently, each person is only allocated a very small plot of land. Each family, on average, manages about 2,000 square meters of land. Too small, there are no economies of scales. In addition, farmers only have rights of use of the land for a limited period of time. So there is a certain disincentive to invest. No one is going to buy a big tractor, invest in big machinery, if they don't know if the land is theirs and for how long they can use it. So there is now a hot debate about granting farmers full ownership of land and allowing them to sell it outright. Now, my view is that this is not a good idea. If farmers were allowed to sell the lands, on one hand, they would receive large income, capital income, about 50,000 renminbi per mu of land. On the other hand, I fear that the farmers, once he receives such large amount of money that probably has never seen before, he will probably squander it immediately. So the net result is that he does not have the land anymore and he does not have the money anymore. So I am personally against allowing today, under the current condition, allowing farmers to sell the land. China is not ready for this. Another alternative, safer, is for farmers instead to lease out the land to a large leaseholder. This new leaseholder could pull together farm plots from various farmers and maybe reach some economies of scale. The problem is that by doing this, farmers' income only grows by a little bit. Now, if farmers really want to increase their income further, what can they do? And this is what we're going to discuss in our next topic, the Hukou registration system in China. We have arranged to meet again with our friends from before in this beautiful place of Malinghe. Doba, Zhuar, eh? Doba. 怎么样？
还可以。
还可以。哎，你看那个这里，看到了那个那里。Hukou indicates the residency status of all Chinese citizens. Some of them have rural Hukou and some of them have urban Hukou. This system was initially introduced to prevent rural residents from moving into the cities.
Since 1978, this restriction has been relaxed, and today rural residents can freely move to the cities.
我们在你家的时候，我们就是这个户口的问题。那我问一下，你们年轻人有什么想法，愿意不愿意搬到城市？这个我还没有考虑过，如果条件合适，我会考虑。但是我是应该不会去到城市，因为现在农村发展比较不错。那如果你去城市打工，你知道你一个月可以赚2000、3000，也不是很少。
那如果是去远的地方，那我就觉得没必要。如果是近一点，可以照看他这个家庭，或者是老人或者小孩。
所以你可以住城市，不过应该是很近的一个地方，
嗯、
不要很远。
对对。
如果你换户口，从农民到市民的户口，你必须反思你的土地。那这个你知道吗？
这个我不是很清楚，但是我一般我不会为了到城市而把这个土地。他到时候人马落叶归根嘛，你到时候如果回来了，土地什么没有了的话，
没地方回去，
那就没地方回去了。还有一个在农村的话，土地可以意味着很多东西，像我们这些风俗的话，人死之后可以葬在自己土地上，那一个姓氏的人全部葬在自己土地上，那到时候过节的时候，比方说祭祀啊、扫墓那些，几十号人、几百号人的话，那就一起去了，很热闹。那样对于这一个姓氏来说，人家看到你的话，这么多人，可能人家会羡慕。哎，对你自己来说，可能是这是一种荣耀，
对
吧？
很有意思。
以家庭和土地侧重一点，啊，赚钱相对来说次要一点，啊，就是这样。
好的，哎，谢谢你，谢谢你，非
常感谢。今天也是很开心。好，
谢
谢，
谢
谢，那就
拜
拜，
拜拜，拜拜，拜拜，
拜拜，
拜拜。So what did our friends tell us? They are very hesitant about moving to the city. They've been thinking about the separation from the family, which is an important factor. Distance from where they live to the city where they would move to, also an important factor. But they don't seem to be aware that if they change the residency status, they will have to give up their land. And once I raised this question, the answer was more clearly in favor of staying in the rural areas.
乡下的户口转在城里面是好嘛噶？
农村户口好，
还是感觉农村好一点。
农村户口现在可以享受一点补贴，是吗？
不愿意。
不愿意。
不愿意。我老了还老了子在村庄好，在老家好。
我很想搬到城市。
这样在哪里好赚钱嘛？就到哪里去赚钱了嘛。
我不需要换户口，因为那个农村户口比城市户口好一点。啊，以前我就是那个居民户口，现在我转农民户口了。
在我们农村的赚钱跟上海差不多，在这里也是100块钱的，我们老家也是100块钱。
多孤独的话，以后要是自己有自己奋斗，自己实现自己的目标，让家人也一起去嘛。
就在外面赚再多钱，总归还是要回去的。
金钱和家庭，这两部分肯定我要把家庭看为更重要一点吧。
如果一个农民想搬到城市换户口，这个简单不简单？有什么条件？有差别吗？
这个问题它是现在是也是中国的一个很大的一个问题。嗯，就是一个农村的户口，它要变为一个城市户口，它还是在中国目前来讲，就是还没有解决这个根本上没有解决这样一个问题。就是现在我们的农民到城市里边打工，他现在他留不下来。他留不下来，就包括到北京、到上海去打工的，就是这些城市，他需要农民去贡献他的劳动力。实际上就是说，他们也不需要他能够在那地方住下来。
就是、对
对，
所以就是临时。
对，临时就是
他们
我们说的农民工嘛。法律上是这样规定的，就是说一个家庭，一个农村现在的就是，一个农村的家庭，就是他已经转变为非农家庭的这种情况，他的政策规定是。必须把他的土地，他承包的土地，把它交给法包方，就是他的村里边。但就目前来讲，这一条，我们没有，好像没有在执行这一条规定。
那现在，
农民和非农民的户口的最大的差别，哪里有最大的好处和坏处？
现在在我们的乡村吧，在乡村，因为我们要搞城市化，城市化，所以就要把很多的这个农民户口呢，把它转变为非农户口，但是也没有什么鼓励的措施，所以因为农民觉得他感觉就是说，转不转好像没什么差别，再加上现在政府对农民的补贴也是比较多，比如说农村户口的孩子上学有补贴，可能城市户口的就没有补贴，等等一些，可能就是政府对农民的补贴会多一点，所以反过来就是农民他现在在乡村一级，他不愿
不愿不太愿意，
对对，就是在农村，就是在县城一级，他可能不愿意把他的户口转变为城市户口。
So we talked about the Hukou, the Chinese registration system, a legacy from the 50s, something that now is becoming less and less relevant, and that is why we are discussing how to reform it. Each type of Hukou, rural or city Hukou, has advantages and disadvantages. Rural Hukou holders have the right to use a plot of land and they receive subsidies from the government for agricultural activities.On the other hand, the holders of a city hukou have access to better services, better healthcare and better school for the children. The other main problem is that when a farmer changes his hukou from rural to city, according to the law, must give up the rights of use of the land. Then what we find in practice is that this law is only randomly applied. It almost seems that each town, each village chooses when and how to apply this law. This creates a little bit of uncertainty in the farmer's mind. It is like, okay, if I move to the city, do I give up my land? Do I need to give up my land or not? The other issue, interesting, and it's a cultural issue, that is when people pass away,If they have a city hukou, the body gets cremated. However, if they have a rural hukou, the body gets buried together with other family members. Many people we talked to told us that this is a very important factor in deciding why not to change the hukou. And it's very similar to what we do in the West. After all, we too bury our relatives together next to each other. So, in summary, if I feel that fewer and fewer farmers are willing to give up the benefits from holding the rural hukou in exchange for the city hukou. All in all, if the number of people willing to move from the rural countryside to the city and change residency status over time diminishes, this would be a big problem for the future of Chinese economic growth that relies just on this migration to fuel its engine. We're almost at the end of our first documentary on China economy and society. In this first episode, we talked about Chinese rural economy because I believe this is an important factor that affects the overall China economic development model. We have worked on this for many years and it was a challenge to put it all into 45 minutes. But these are some comments and thoughts that I want to leave you with.Last year, for the first time in the history of China, the proportion of urban residents crossed the 50% threshold, and the future of China's economic development relies largely on this flow of migrants to continue for the next two decades. However, we found that today fewer and fewer farmers are willing to leave the countryside to move to the cities. Living conditions in the rural areas have improved,and the relative attraction factor of the cities is becoming weaker and weaker. So, if you believe that at the gate of every city there are millions of farmers ready to move there, this is the wrong assumption. And this could be a problem. And paradoxically, this problem is the very result of the extraordinary success of economic reforms that have narrowed the gap between urban and rural living.Microcredit is often used by farmers not to improve the productivity of farmlands, but for example, to repair their homes, to improve general living conditions, which indicates the farmer's priority is not to make more money, but simply to live a more comfortable life. In China, there is a hot debate as to whether to grant farmers full ownership of the land and allow them to sell it outright. In my view, farmers should not be given this right. Why? Because if they do that, on one hand, they will sell the only asset that they own. And on the other hand, there is a risk that they could squander the money they receive and at the end being left with nothing. Chinese policymakers are also discussing how to reform the Hukou system, which means allowing migrant workers to have access to services almost similar to those of urban residents. All in all, what are all these reforms, all these policies aimed at? They are aimed at persuading farmers that moving to the cities actually offers many advantages. From an investment point of view, Chinese agriculture remains backwards and does not have economies of scale. A foreign operator could, for example, rent out plots of land from various farmers, pool it together and manage large-scale farms, thus reaching economies of scale. In this first documentary on China economy and society, we discussed the rural to urban migration potential from the point of view of those who are still living in the countryside. In the next one, we will look at what these migrant workers do when they go to the cities, how they work in the manufacturing industry, and how this fuels China exports, a key pillar of Chinese economy. Well, I hope you have enjoyed it so far, and we invite you to follow us on our next show. Thank you very much, and goodbye. 再见.